All right, thank you all for joining in on this question and answer study focused around the Dead Sea Scrolls faith. This is the second study that we've been doing. We did our first one last week, and as I said, the intention is to do this once a week on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. consistently. If there ever is a time where we cannot do that, then we'll try to reschedule to a different day of the week. But otherwise, Wednesdays will be the day that we will try to do it. And if a lot of people start expressing interest in this, then we can have a discussion and debate about perhaps a better day to do it on, if it's not convenient for a lot of people. So, for now, it'll be on Wednesdays. So, as I said, this is a question and answer study, and so for those who are here live with me, they are given the opportunity to ask questions about any topic related to the Dead Sea Scrolls or to the Bible in general. And to the idea is to ask these questions to get an understanding of what the faith of the Dead Sea Scrolls teaches on all different types of issues. Because a lot of people, most Messianics or most other Jews, the teachings you hear will always be from other Jewish groups, like the Pharisees, the rabbis. You always hear from them. And you don't really hear too much from the Essenes, who were the writers of the Dead Sea Scrolls. You don't really hear much at all about what they had to say on different issues. So they're kind of ignored. And I believe that's very unfair, because I think they're actually the true movement of the Jews that were closest to the one true faith that the Messiah and the apostles followed. So what I have to share is very fresh perspective compared to most other teachers, because most other teachers are very much grounded in their Pharisee studies and their Pharisee rabbinic leaders that they look up to and that they hold as authoritative or as reliable sources. But so now people have already asked questions. They've typed it out, and I'm going to start answering some of these questions now. So, David asks, I am interested in the writing of Jesus. What can you tell me about it? So, basically, for the most part, at least from what's been preserved to us, he never wrote anything except a very small amount of things. The one writing that I know off at the top of my head, which I believe he wrote, and which is attributed to him, is a letter that he wrote to a king who was asking for the Messiah to come to him and heal him. And he basically said to the king, I can't come there right now. I have something I have to do. I have my mission that's given to me. I cannot go there, but I'm going to send someone else. I'm going to send one of my disciples there, and he will heal you. He will give you what you are looking for from me. And then there's another document which relates how one of his disciples went to that king and did what the Messiah had written to him that he would have his disciple do for him. So that's really the main writing that is connected with him specifically that he wrote. There are other writings, however, that I mentioned, which are actually more teachings from him, where he gives more visions, more revelations, more secret teachings, and the apostles each record them in their own different writings. And, you know, we've got, as I said last week, you know, you've got the New Testament, but most of it's Paul. And you look at the apostles, the 12 apostles, where did all the other writings from the apostles go? You know, you would think that the apostles that they would have written something. And but so where are they? You know, they're not in the New Testament. Well, there's a lot of other writings out there which claim to be from the apostles, and they give more words of the Messiah's teachings. And in the Ethiopian Bible, in there, it preserves a huge amount of his teachings in some of these extra books about the law of the new covenant. And so basically he commands the apostles to write down these new laws, and that's what the Ethiopian books are about. But so that's essentially the answer for that question of the writing of him. Now hold on one second here. Okay. So I'm going to go on to the next question now. That is, Sandra says, last week you were reading something and you said that the Spirit wrote the Torah on the hearts of men in 70 languages. About what date was the writing? And then she also said, I hardly believe that it was in English. So I read from a document last week, which was compiled by a rabbinic Jew. But this it's called the Legends of the Jews, okay? And this was compiled by Lewis Ginsburg, and he took all different kinds of sources and combined it together to form like a flowing narrative. So some of his sources are good, and some of his sources are bad. So you have to, when you're reading from this compilation that Lewis did, you have to be careful reading the information, what it says. And so I was reading from certain passages from his compilation, and the passages that I was reading are the claiming to be from Moses. It is extra revelations, extra teachings that Moses was given. Now, the date of that, as I said, was compiled by the rabbis. He used different sources, so I'd have to look at... He specifies the sources in his footnotes. I'd have to look and figure out, like, each thing that he notes of where he got it from to figure out the exact date of all the different pieces that he's getting his information from. But the specific writing that he was... that he had there, the Moses writing, it, one second here, the 70 languages, that is a common phrase in rabbinic thought, so it's not entirely clear if that phrase, 70 languages, occurred in the original book of Moses that was being quoted from. But the idea of the 70 languages was with the Tower of Babel. After that happened, the people were divided and they're into 70 different nations or groups, tribes, and a language was assigned to each one of them. Of those languages that were assigned to them, none of them were the English. Those 70 languages were very different than the languages that exist today. And I mean, that's basically what I can say about it. The dating is very unclear due to how he combined so many different things. So I'll go on to the next question now. Before I go on to the next question, it looks like we lost a couple people. Let's see here. Well, hopefully they will come back, but if not, it'll be recorded for them. So the calendar. The question is, regarding the calendar, this was asked by Peter. He says, the calendar, when does the year begin and how is it determined? So, basically, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, we have several different documents, which they considered scripture, and which I do as well, which give in great detail how the calendar works. So, as we know, Jude in the New Testament says that Enoch, he endorses Enoch as valid prophecy, a true writing of scripture. The Dead Sea Scrolls confirm that, and many other writings confirm that as well. And so, in Enoch, we are told that there are 360 days every year, and then there's four special extra days, intercalary days, which are added to divide the seasons. They're the season marker days. So in total, it's 364 days. But we're told by Enoch, I think it's in chapter 74, we're told that even though there's 364 days, it's to be counted as 360. So we know that he's saying 364 days, not 365 days. That's very important because many people who are trying to figure out what the correct calendar is when they're trying to do Enoch's calendar, they're following a 365-day calendar. But that actually goes contrary to what Enoch is saying, because if Enoch was teaching a 365, he would have said there's 360 days and then there's five extra days that you don't count. But he didn't say that. He said there's four extra days you don't count. Okay, so now the problem is when you do 364 like Enoch requires, over time you'll lose certain you'll lose days over time. Enoch gives a system which I believe is pointing to the system of matching the solar year, synchronizing it with the lunar year. In chapter, I think it's 74 again, Enoch gives three distinct periods where you are to synchronize the two calendars together. They are three-year intervals, five-year intervals, and eight-year intervals. And we know what the three-year interval is. That is, with the lunar calendar, every 3 years, they have to add an extra month to catch up, to synchronize it. Every 8 years, there is something very special that occurs every 8 years. I forget the exact way to pronounce the name of the phenomenon that scholars call it, but it basically indicates that every 8 years, the sun and moon line up together naturally without any changes happening. So it's a natural realignment. And then every 5 years, that just leaves every 5 years. There are certain indications in the text of Enoch which tell us that every 5 years we are to use the moon to make sure the year is accurate and remains 364 days. And I can go into greater detail on that for those who want me to. If you want, you can ask about that, or we can do it in another session of showing, like going through the actual text of Enoch. What we see is Enoch and Jubilees are telling us 364 days. Okay, now why do they say 364 and not 365? It's because they want the calendar was intended to be divisible by seven. We see divisibility by seven all throughout Scripture. The Jubilees, the Sabbath years, the Sabbath weeks, or the week years, it's all divisible by seven. And so we see that the intent of this calendar is so that the days of the year will always be on the same day of the week every year. So it makes it very simple. You don't have to figure out every year when the Sabbath is going to be or when the what day of the month it's going to be, what day of the week. It's all set the same time every year. So it's a much more it's a system that is much less complicated, in which which attest more to the intelligence of our Creator, rather than the system that the others are telling us, which is kind of like all over the place, and it's very hard to follow, you know, difficult to track it. And so, based on this seven divisibility thing, it begins, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, on the fourth day of the week. And the reason for that is, since the calendar is based on the sun and the moon as secondary, but since it's based on those, and since those were made on the fourth day of the week, that's when it starts. So you start with the fourth day of the week, you add 364 days, it's the fourth day of the week again. You add 364 days again, and it's also the fourth day of the week once again. And that's how it goes every year. It's always the same day of the week according to these documents. I'm going to read through Enoch, the passage that I was talking about, to show where it's the justification for it, what I said. But let me say one other thing on this topic, is that the Book of Psalms was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls in many copies, but what's very special about these copies is that it preserves a version of the Book of Psalms for us that's very different. It has psalms in a different order, it has extra psalms in it, and what we see is that the Book of Psalms in the oldest version that survives, the Dead Sea Scrolls, present something very different, and which seems to have evidence that it's the more correct version, it's the more original version. So in this more original version, I'm going to read to you right now what it says, and this is relevant to the calendar of when the day, what day the calendar begins. So, here's what it says. This is in column 27 of the scroll identified as scholars, but by scholars as 11Q5. And it says, this is in the Book of Psalms. And David, son of Jesse, was wise in a light like the light of the sun, and learned and discerning and perfect in all his paths before God and men. And Yahuwah gave him a discerning and enlightened spirit. And he wrote Psalms 3,600, and songs to be sung before the altar over the perpetual offering of every day for all the days of the year, 364. And for the Sabbath offerings, 52 songs. And for the offerings of the first days of the months, and for all the days of the festivals, and for the Day of Atonement, 30 songs. And all the songs which he spoke were 446, and songs to perform over the possessed, 4. The total was 4,050. All these he spake through prophecy, which had been given to him from before the Most High. So, hold on a second. Alright. So, David, basically, according to the Book of Psalms, what I just read, it tells us that David wrote 4,050 songs and psalms, 3,600 of them were psalms, the remainder were songs, and most of David's songs were about the calendar. And what's very amazing is that we found other scrolls in the Dead Sea Scrolls which correspond with what we're told that David wrote. So it says David wrote, let me see what he said. It said, for the Sabbath offerings, 52 songs. Well, guess what we have in the Dead Sea Scrolls? We have a document that was found, which is called Sabbath Songs, Songs for the Sabbath Sacrifice, or something like that. And basically, in that text, it doesn't say this is Song of David, but it reads like David, and it matches exactly with what the Book of Psalms just told us from the Dead Sea Scrolls, that he wrote a song for the Sabbath offering, for each Sabbath. the whole book of Sabbath songs is not preserved. But about the first 25%, one-fourth of the document is preserved. So it gives us the first 13 Sabbath songs for the year. But what's very important about these Sabbath songs is that David tells us in those songs what day of the week and what day of the month those days are. So basically, if we accept this writing as David's, then that means it's prophetic and thus scripture. And if David is telling us this, then he's our authority. And if he's telling us about the calendar, how it works, we have to follow what he's saying. And since this document, the Sabbath songs in the Dead Sea Scrolls, clearly tell us what day of the week it is to begin, what each Sabbath day is to begin, this means that the Sabbath songs tell us what day of the year it begins. So the Sabbath songs are key. That's one of the key documents which proves the correct calendar system. Most people, when they're trying to do the Enoch calendar, are not following the Sabbath songs. They don't accept the Sabbath songs because the Sabbath songs contradict what their calendar understanding is. But if we just simply follow these writings and accept what they're saying, accept their authority, then we won't be coming to our own conclusions independent of Scripture, but what we're teaching will be in full agreement with all the Scriptures. So David's reckoning, David's counting, agrees exactly with the reckoning that the calendar documents in the Dead Sea Scrolls tell us as well. The calendar documents in the scrolls date the festivals, Sabbaths, for the days of the year, and use put it on the solar calendar, but then they also have documents which show the solar calendar in combination with the lunar. And that's exactly what Enoch told us to do, to synchronize the two. So we see that they're following that system that Enoch was teaching. So I'm going to read now from the section of Enoch, okay? And let's see here. Let me just, here it is. Here's the book. So basically, most people, the version that they're using from R.H. Charles, most people, the version they're using of Enoch is from R.H. Charles's latest edition. His latest edition alters the text of the Ethiopian text, and he changes it to something that it doesn't say in the copies. But he makes up a reading based on his belief that that what the text says is an error. So I'm going to read what the text says. And that is in chapter 74 of the Book of Enoch. And here's what it has to say after giving... So it gives the laws for the solar calendar. And then it gives the laws for the lunar calendar. And after it gives those laws, it tells us, let's see here. All right, so it says, thus I saw their positions, the sun rising and setting according to the order of their months. And in those days, the sun has an overplus of 30 days in 5 years taken together. In all the days which belong to one of those, 5 full years amount to 364 days. And the overplus of the sun and the stars amounts to 6 days. In 5 years, 6 days every year come to 30 days. And the moon falls behind the sun and stars to the number of 30 days. And the moon brings in all the years exactly, so that their position is not prematurely advanced or delayed by a single day unto eternity. But they complete the changing years with perfect justice in 364 days. In 3 years, there are 1,092 days, and in 5 years, 1,820 days, so that in 8 years, there are 2,912 days. In 3 years, there accrue to the moon herself 1,062 days, and in 5 years, she falls 50 days behind. At the close of these, an addition is made to the 1,062 days. And in 5 years, there are 1,770 days, so that the days in 8 lunar years amount to 2,832. Thus, in the 8 years, she falls behind to the amount of 80 days, and the sum total of the days she falls behind in 8 years is 80. And the year is accurately completed in conformity with their stations, and the stations of the sun as they rise from the portals through which it rises and sets 30 days. So, that passage that I read tells us that, as I said, the one verse it says, and the moon brings in all the years exactly, so that their position is not prematurely advanced or delayed by a single day unto eternity, but complete the changing years with perfect justice in 364 days. Other translations, most other translations you're going to read, are using R.H. Charles' altered text. And his altered text, instead of saying the moon in that passage, it says the sun and stars. So is it the sun and the stars, as R.H. Charles changed it to, or is it, as the Ethiopian text says, the moon? Although I should mention that some of the manuscripts differ. They don't all just say moon. Sometimes they say moon and stars. I think a few even say moon, stars, and sun altogether. But they all say moon. But R.H. Charles changed it so that he removed moon from this. So my position is that everything we see in Scripture is important. And so when Enoch is giving very detailed instructions here, I don't think he's just spouting off random numbers, but that the numbers he gives us are very intentional. So he tells us how the year is synchronized every 3 years, every 5 years, and every 8 years. But what we see in this chapter is that he gives very special focus on 5 years. He mentions that more than the other. He starts out saying 5 years, and then he says 3, 5, and 8. So he's giving extra emphasis on the 5 years. And he says the moon is what keeps it, so that 364 days it remains and doesn't prematurely delay or advance. So now, and this was from chapter 74, what I read. And so now here's the problem. Enoch doesn't explain exactly, in at least from what we have preserved in this book, the intercalation process to use, like how the moon is to be used. It doesn't say how to do that. There are two possibilities for why that is. One is he might have explained it in another book, or two, the Dead Sea Scrolls, it's not entirely certain, due to sometimes the conclusions of the scholars are sometimes uncertain, but the scholarly consensus, which is worth taking into consideration, is that the calendar section of the Book of Enoch was much longer originally, much longer, and that it was shortened by scribes. And if that's true, then it's possible that in the fuller version, we were given the details for how to do that intercalation process. But there is one other book, which goes by the name of Enoch. It's not as reliable, it's not preserved as reliable as the Book of Enoch, but it's called Second Enoch, or Slavonic Enoch. And in that book, what's interesting is that many manuscripts of that book have it altered so that it agrees with the Gregorian years or the Gregorian reckoning. But in other manuscripts, it has the 364 days, not 365. like the other manuscripts have. So it shows that the scribes were altering some of the numbers in this book called Second Enoch. But so in that book of Second Enoch, which has a lot of added things by the scribes and things taken away and things altered, it says one thing in here in Second Enoch, which sounds very authentic to me, and which to me corresponds, it corresponds with what I've been saying about the system. Thank you for joining in, those who got knocked out, and for newcomers, thank you. I'm going through the calendar. I was asked questions about the calendar, so I'm going through that. So here's the passage. I'm opening to it right now from 2nd Enoch. It says, and the moon has a sevenfold intercalation. It says other stuff too, but that's the key phrase right there. The moon has a sevenfold intercalation. How I'm interpreting that is that it's basically saying the moon is to be used to intercalate by a divisibility by seven, a sevenfold, a seven divisibility. And so that would agree with the system that I presented, where every 5 years, on average, a week is added. And why is it a week? Because the 364 days are divisible by seven, and to maintain that divisibility by seven, you have to add a week every so often when it's needed. And I did the math a long time ago. I did the math on how often this would be required to add a week. And the average I got was something like 5.6 years on average, roughly. So you're seeing it's 5, but perhaps slightly closer to 6. But what we see with the intercalation of, like, for the 3 years that I mentioned, how every 3 years the lunar calendar has to add an extra month to catch up, that system is not exactly 3 years, just so you know. It's usually 3 years, but then sometimes it's not every 3 years. It changes sometimes. But for the most part, it's every 3 years. Similarly, when Enoch says every 5 years, it's not always 5 years, but it's on average 5 years, okay? So Enoch is giving the averages for the how to reconcile the two different calendar systems. And that everything I presented all it makes sense, it agrees with what Enoch is saying. So just to kind of recap here, we've got the Sabbath songs that David wrote. According to the Book of Psalms, David wrote those Sabbath songs, and the Sabbath songs tell us what days of the week, and what days of the month, and what days of the year each of the Sabbaths are on. And the calendar texts found in the Dead Sea Scrolls agree with those exact numbers. But so, since David is telling us that the calendar has to always begin on the fourth day of the week, you're going to lose time over time, since all we have to do is observe with scientific insight that, or just, you know, not necessarily scientific insight, but our own experience. If you only do 364 days without an intercalation, then it's going to fall behind. We know this is true because we've lived our lives. If you only do 364, it's falling one day behind for the Gregorian calendar. And if you keep doing that without adding something eventually, it's going to be so far behind. Eventually, let's say in 50 years, you're going to be behind almost 2 months. You're going to be, the beginning of your year is going to be in January instead of March. So there has to be some type of system of adding a seven period so that it'll always begin on the day that David says it has to begin on, and that it'll maintain the divisibility, the 364. There has to be a system for that, and the system that I've presented from what the Book of Enoch says, every 5 years there's supposed to be an intercalation, and then Second Enoch tells us the intercalation is sevenfold. So that all matches. Now hold on, someone's messaging me. I think they might want to join. Well, let me see what they're saying. Okay. All right, so let me think, is there anything else to say about the calendar? There's other documents which also agree with the solar calendar. So you've got the Book of Revelation tells us the calendar is, it tells us 1260 days divides into, it tells us it divides into 3.5 years. And 42 months, when you do the math, those numbers make it so that it is 42 months of 30 days, which is exactly the system that Enoch teaches us. So a year of 360 days. And Genesis says the same thing in the Genesis account. Genesis tells us the chronology of the flood, and that chronology doesn't reconcile with the lunar calendar, but it's a solar calendar of 30-day months. And now the specific verse from Second Enoch that I had read was, it is chapter 16, verse 8 in the long version. But I've read other translations before, and I've seen that they differ. The translations differ. The one I was reading from is Charlesworth. That's the one I was reading from. So that's the system that I believe the scriptures teach. It makes very logical sense. It follows everything that the Dead Sea Scrolls are saying, David is saying. And so hopefully that answers the question sufficiently. There's so much stuff. I want to say one thing about this. Why does Enoch say 364 days instead of 365? Because as the science experts tell us, the year is 365 days plus a little quarter. Well, there's a reason why it says 364, and actually Enoch is more correct than the scientists are. But here's how. The scientists are counting days by, they're counting days by 24-hour periods. But that's not what Enoch in Scripture is counting by. They're counting by complete periods from sunset to sunset, or, you know, some people don't believe the sunset to sunset viewpoint. Some do the sunrise to sunrise. But in either case, it doesn't matter which, but it's going from one specific point to another specific point. That same exact time. Complete periods to serve as a day. And when you do the math, in every year except the leap year, so 3 out of 4 years, it's always 364 days, complete days, 364 complete days. The extra day and a quarter does not make a complete day. It's basically like this. Here's how they're telling us. You have 365 and then a quarter. So you can't have a quarter day, so you have to take it off. And then every 4 years, you have to add that day back. That's how their system is. Enoch, however, says, no, you have 364 days, and the 1.25, it's not at the end, but it's like it's divided on each side. So you have like half of 1.25 on this side and the other half on this side. And basically, you know, half of that, half of 1.25 is like 0.6125 or something like that. And both, you know, 0.6125, that is not a complete day. So you have to take that off because you can't have that as a day. It's not a full day. Same thing off the other side. 0.6125, that's not a full day. You cut that off. And that's why it's 364 and not 365. So in actuality, the scriptures are teaching the truth that it is exactly 364 complete days. But as I said, in the leap year, it's different in the leap year. But Enoch was giving us the details that Enoch gave us were only for the year that he was showing to us. So he wasn't showing us the laws during the leap year. He was showing us the laws of the year that he was being shown for that specific time. So Enoch is really correct, and when he says 364, that's the truth. It is 364, and it's just a matter of how you divide the remaining 1.25 period of 24 hours. How do you divide it? You divide it according to Enoch's system on each side, but not the Gregorian system. They're putting it all together and putting it on the one side. So that's why it's 364, and another thing to note is that Enoch's system teaches geocentrism. It teaches that the stars and the sun are going around the Earth rather than the Earth going around the sun. So that also changes some things too in how you understand. Okay, and so the question is, how is the moon used in the 5-year calculation? It's kind of similar to how the sun is used in the 3-year calculation of the moon. So basically every 3 years you're comparing the moon to the sun, and you're saying, oh look, the moon system is going too far behind. We need to add another month to catch it up with the sun so that they're not too far apart. It's the same thing but in reverse for the 5-year system. Instead, what we're seeing is, okay, the calendar for the sun is drifting away from the moon. It's going too far away from it. So we need to add a week so that it realigns with the moon and so that they're at the place where they're supposed to be. And just so you know, the moon system that we're told in Enoch doesn't fit 100% exactly the lunar system. So in other words, it tells us average, like it tells us certain, like it says 29 days in this month, 30 days in this month, and it goes back and forth. But the problem is, sometimes, some months, it's 28 days, it differs sometimes. And Enoch even tells us that in the book of Enoch. He says, some months, it's 28 days. It says that, I forget which chapter it was, but it's in the laws of the moon. So, the numbers that he's giving are the default, the normal, the system that is the main system it works on. Another thing to note is a lot of Enoch's numbers that he gives us for the calendar system is actually only working at a small part of the world. How that is to be understood is he's giving us the default. Okay, he's giving us the center. This is the center. And then everything else stems from off it, but it's corresponding to the default. So allow me to explain. Enoch tells us that when it's spring and fall, the day is 9 parts light and 9 parts dark. And that's the same for everywhere on the earth. It's the same everywhere on the earth. But what Enoch tells us is that the first day of summer and the first day of winter, it is 12 parts versus 6. For the summer, it's 12 parts light, 6 parts dark. And for the winter, it's reversed. But that is only true at one part of the world. One horizontal line across the world. And then everywhere else in that hemisphere has a different time, but follows a ratio. It follows the same ratios, but it's a different time. So when you're at the equator, your spring and fall will be the same everywhere else, but your summer and winter will be almost exactly as the same as the spring and the fall. It will be about nine parts. Because the sun is pretty much having the same relationship to the earth the entire year. When you're at the North Pole or the South Pole, or basically when you're in the Arctic region, there will always be at least one day of the year where it is complete daylight or complete darkness. And the reason for that is, the relationship of the sun to the earth, the angle that the sunlight is hitting it. And so when the sun is going around at the time of summer in the North Pole, the sun is always coming to the face of the North Pole. The sun is never being behind the earth so that the North Pole can't get any light. It's always being, the light of the sun is always hitting the North Pole at all times during the summer. But at that same time, at the opposite end for the South Pole, it is not getting any sunlight because the sunlight is only hitting the North Pole. It's not hitting the South Pole. And so the South Pole is having a really dark time, the whole time, 24 hours of darkness. And what we're seeing is any place you go on Earth, it has different numbers for when it's, for how many days, how many parts of light and how many parts of night. And so Enoch's parts that he tells us is only telling us the default, and you must not make the mistake of following what Enoch is telling you wherever you live. You must not make the mistake of following those literal measurements. What you need to do is take his measurements, that's the standard, and then convert them to what time zone you are, what place you are on the earth. So Enoch is just giving us the centerpiece. And instead, because the only other way for Enoch to have done it, well, he would have had to tell us every single place on earth what the time differences would have been. And that would have taken forever to give to list out the time, the exact parts for each place on the earth. That would have taken forever. So all he does for us is tell us the centerpiece, and then everyone else on all parts of the earth have to correspond where they are to the ratio that Enoch is giving us. So that's kind of the basic understanding of how the Enoch calendar works. Now let me say one more thing about this, which throws people off, and that is, when is sunrise and when is sunset? According to the scientists and the secular world, we are told that sunrise begins when the first speck of the sun, when you can see the first speck of the actual sun come above the horizon. That's when sunrise is. And sunset is when the last speck, hits the horizon of the sun. That's what they're telling us, but that is not the system that Scripture speaks of. The Dead Sea Scrolls tells us, and this makes sense, it tells us that the sunrise and sunset are marked when the sun is divided in half. So half of the sun is below the horizon and half of it is above. And the reason that this makes sense is that you have to think of the earth like a globe, right? The halfway mark, which is what sunrise and sunset would be, that would be the dividing line where half of the sun is above and half below. And when you do that, it actually changes when sunrise and sunset is. Like if you're using websites online, the websites will tell you when is sunrise, when is sunset. But when you're comparing what they're telling you to what Enoch is telling us, it's not it's not adding up. The days are off. It's way too off. It doesn't work. But when you do it with the system of the halfway below and halfway above is when the sunrise and sunset is, then it matches what we are experiencing through the seasons. It matches exactly. And so, you know, we have to follow what Enoch is saying. And since Enoch's system only agrees with the sunrise and sunset being marked by the sun being halfway below and halfway above the horizon, that's the system we have to use. And that's going to throw off, that'll throw off your day by at least 10 minutes. I looked it up and it throws it off by about 10 minutes. 5 minutes on this side and 5 minutes on the other side. So, it comes 5 minutes too early for sunrise, based on what the scientists are telling you. And then, sunset is happening 5 minutes too late, what they're telling you, from what it actually is. So you have to be careful. Like, you know, the Sabbath begins at sunset, or, you know, some people do it sunrise, but the Sabbath begins, and when it begins, you have to do it when it begins. You can't make exceptions and still be working when it's a little bit after. You have to make sure that when it's exactly beginning the Sabbath, you're not doing work anymore. And so that makes it very important to find out, when does the actual Sabbath begin at the exact moment? And the exact moment, according to this, is the sun being halfway below and halfway above. Because that agrees with Enoch's measurements exactly. So, hopefully that answers the questions about the calendar. There's so much other stuff, but that's the main things. You don't really have to figure out the lunar too much. The lunar, following the lunar, the main thing about the lunar is making sure you are at the right time. If you lose the time, the moon is there to help you realign yourself to the correct time. But so long as you know the correct time of the sun, the moon is not so much important. But there is a purpose and function for the lunar, and how that is important for us checking time and making sure we're doing it right. But since it's much more complicated, the lunar, for those who are beginning to do the Enoch calendar or who are still having a hard time making the lunar, making sense of the lunar system, I would advise just to follow the system, the solar system that Enoch is telling us, and you'll pretty much, as long as you're following the set specifications every year, you'll be doing it correct. Yeah, that's about the Enoch calendar. Now, all right, so, and yeah, for those who are not good at figuring this stuff out, is there a calendar that we can download? That was asked by Sandra. There's a calendar. I can make a calendar for you guys so that you can see what the system I've just presented to you indicates. And I'll give you a little key or a rule thing at the beginning, which will say, follow this process every year, and you'll be good. So I'll try to prepare that for you all to help you, because it is complicated for those who are not mathematically minded. But people are not really... You see, for instance, in Jubilees tells us stuff about the calendar, but people reject Jubilees because of the calendar issue. For those who don't like the solar calendar of Enoch, they reject Jubilees for that reason. From my perspective, I am convinced these documents are scripture, and if they are, then we have to follow what they're saying. So, if Jubilees is scripture, we got to follow what it's saying on the calendar. Same thing for Enoch, and the same thing for the Sabbath songs of David, and the calendar texts. So, yeah, and for Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement, the lunar calendar has already done that. The system that I'm using, we are doing that. It's beginning late Thursday afternoon or mid-afternoon Thursday, and goes to Friday mid-afternoon. And but yeah, as I said, Enoch, people who keep the Enoch calendar, they're differing on how to keep it. A lot of people are doing 365 Enoch calendar, but I believe that's incorrect because Enoch's telling us 364, not 365. Their reasoning, I've heard some people reason that the calendar was changed in Joshua's time. They say Joshua's time, or they say Hezekiah's time. And they say, for that reason, now the year is 365 days. It wasn't before, but now it is. I don't believe that's correct, though. Enoch actually tells us that these laws, the 364-day calendar system, that's going to be forever, until the new creation. So if we trust Enoch, he's telling us that's always going to be the case. It's not going to be 365. It's not going to change. And Jubilees says something similar. It basically says, in Jubilees, Moses, listen, the Israelites, soon after you die, they're going to abandon the 364-day calendar. They're not going to do the calendar anymore so that it'll be only 364 days. Instead, their calendar is going to have other days. It's not going to be fully 364. It's going to be the lunar. Or it's not going to be exactly 364 days. And then it says it's going to mess up the four extra days. They're going to mess it up. They're not going to do those four intercalary days correctly. And that's what they're doing. They're not doing it correctly. Even those who are trying to do the Enoch calendar, they're doing it wrong. For those who are doing the 365 day, because they're messing up the 4 day count, and they're messing up the 364 day count because they're doing 365. So where are we now in the 5 year period? Basically, how you determine that is, you see, as I said, the year always begins on the fourth day of the week. So what you want to do is see the closest fourth day of the week to the spring equinox, or, you know, basically when the first day of spring is in where you're living. Where you're living, the first day of spring, the closest fourth day to that is when you want, is when the year begins. And so what you see is, if, because it goes behind 1 day every year or so, and then every leap year or some, you know, to the 2 days, when you go behind more than 3 days, when you go behind the spring more than 3 days, the closest fourth day of the week is a whole week ahead. So you see, when your closest fourth day of the week is an extra week after your 364th day, that's when you add it. So you basically have to do is do 364 days every year, always. Do that. And then, if the beginning of your year, if this first day of spring, if the fourth day that's closest to the first day of spring in your area is a week after your 364th day, you add that extra week. So you just have to look and see. I don't have it offhand what time of when we are in the count of the 5 years, but you just follow along with. You don't really need to know ahead of time. You can just, when it's your 364th day, you see, okay, how long until the next fourth day that's closest to the spring in your area. If you're the 364th day and the day after is the closest fourth day to the spring, that's when you don't add anything. You just do it regularly. And every year, when it's the 364th day, the next fourth day is the day after. So you keep doing it like that. But if the next if the closest fourth day of the week is 1 week after your 364th day, then you have to add that week. So hopefully that clarifies how to do it. And Yom Kippur, the question was asked, are we to fast or not? It's funny, when you first said that, I thought at first you meant, are we too fast? As in, like, did you do it too quickly? You know, too soon. That's what I thought you meant at first. But of course, that's not what you meant. Are we to do fasting on this day? I believe we are. The New Testament writings tell us this. And it says to afflict your souls. And what we're told in, you know, these writings is that on the Sabbath day, you're not supposed to fast. Jubilees tells us that. The book of Jubilees says that. Don't fast. Why? Because you're afflicting your soul on that day. Or you're making your soul downcast. Nehemiah says a similar thing. On a festival day, you're not supposed to weep. You're not supposed to mourn. The people, when they were hearing the law read in Nehemiah, they were mourning and weeping because of, oh, I can't believe, you know, this law is so amazing, but we've broken it so badly. And they were weeping in repentance. And then Nehemiah, or maybe it was Ezra, rebukes them and says, this is a holy day, a festival day. Do not mourn. Do not be sad on a holy day, because this is a time for rejoicing and gladness of heart. So the basic idea, you know, don't be downcast in your soul. And as I said, the Sabbath Jubilee says that we're not allowed to fast on the Sabbath. And so it seems to me the evidence indicates that, you know, afflicting your soul requires fasting. And what does it require fasting from? The pleasures of your flesh, things you enjoy doing. You know, we're told, do not go after your own pleasure. That's even for the Sabbath, but especially for the Day of Atonement. Don't go after things you enjoy doing. Don't go after, you know, physical pleasure. And don't, you know, and don't sleep with your spouse. Don't do type of those activities, which is all about fulfilling the lust of your flesh. And there are times where fulfilling the lust of the flesh in the proper way the scriptures command it to be done, there are time and place for that. But on the holy days, we're not supposed to fulfill the lust of the flesh. And so that's how I would keep the Day of Atonement. So, yeah, I mean, especially in the Day of Atonement, you're not supposed to really do stuff like that, like sports. Some people think sports are okay on regular Sabbath, but I would say it seems to me that if you're doing competition, that it's not okay on the Sabbath, because that is a spirit of self-glory, you know, who's gonna win, that type of thing, which seems to me very wrong. But as it's a if you're playing a game with someone, but it's not competitive, but you're just having fun together, like passing a ball around, perhaps that's okay. I'm not going to say that it is okay, because I'm not sure on that issue. But there's a clear difference between just having a good time with everyone and you're just having fun, and then trying to win or competing. That's a very different spirit of playing different things. So, and then the question was asked, how do you feel about burnt offerings on Yom Kippur? Not animal or flesh, just fragrant offerings. Well, the scriptures basically tell us we're not supposed to be doing offerings on our own. We're not supposed to be doing them outside the priesthood system. We're not supposed to be doing them away from the holy place without a Levitical priest who is ordained the proper way. So I would say, you know, we're not supposed to be doing that. And the Dead Sea Scrolls tell us, for instance, on the Sabbath, the only sacrifices which are allowed on the Sabbath are the ones which are for specifically designated for the Sabbath. So you're not supposed to do free will offerings on Sabbath, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, because it's work that's not needed. The work that is needed for the priesthood is the sacrifices which are required on that day. So certain sin offerings are required on that day, like if you just gave birth, you know, the 40th or 80th day, you have to do a sacrifice, even if it's on Sabbath. But if it's, but otherwise, you know, if it's not a offering that's mandatory, you should not be doing the sacrifices on Sabbath, and that goes the same for the Day of Atonement. Those sacrifices are, they're not supposed to be done. So the fragrant offerings, you should not do those, especially since we're not priests in the Levitical sense. And those offerings are only to be done in the Levitical system for Day of Atonement. Now let me just read a couple things that people were saying just to make sure I didn't miss anything. Let me see here. Okay, so that's gone through all the questions so far. Now, do you guys have more questions to ask? If you do, enter them in the box, and let me just check to see if people are trying to get in. Let's see. Alright. Alright, so so the question was asked, did the Essenes sacrifice animals? Did they consume meat? There were different groups of Essenes, first of all. The Church Fathers, for instance, give a bunch of different groups, Gnostic groups, you know, all these different groups. And some of these groups that he says, this one church father says was Essene, they were marked with things that are radically different than what we see in the Dead Sea Scrolls and what Josephus and Philo tell us about the Essenes. So it seems to me, from what I've looked at, that there were certain Essene groups which were kind of like, in a sense, heretics from the original Essene group. They were Gnostics. It seems like the Gnostics kind of branched out of the Essene movement, and they went radically in a different direction. And so that there were certain groups which might have called themselves Essene, which believed that eating meat was wrong and that they didn't approve of these sacrifices in the scriptures. But what we see in the scrolls paints a different picture for what the Essenes believed. What we see in the scrolls is that the sacrifices, the documents of the Essenes are even more pro-sacrifices than the regular scriptures are. Like, there's even more information about how to do sacrifices, extra sacrifices. It's a lot more emphasis on the importance of sacrifices in the Essene scriptures. And also, you know, about eating meat. There's a lot of stuff about that. So it seems to be the case that, you know, the Essenes lived, or they believed, that it was not wrong to eat meat, and that sacrificing animals was what the law required, and that it was a good thing. What happened, however, is that some of the Essenes, a good number of them, lived celibate lives. They didn't want to be married. Because they felt it was superior for themselves, and they get greater honor through avoiding that lifestyle. And they did, from my understanding, they did a similar thing with eating meat, so that some Essenes chose voluntarily to not eat meat, and that was a greater honor for themselves, that it wasn't required of everybody. Because the scripture just, the Essene writings in the Dead Sea Scrolls cannot be reconciled with this idea of it being wrong. And as for sacrifices, it seems to me that they may have done their own sacrifices with some of their priests, but then later on they stopped doing them. So that's what it seems like to me at first. They were doing their own, then they came to conclude that the new covenant was here, and that the new covenant has brought in the way so that not that the sacrifices are gone forever, but that the sacrifices in the current system that was being done was too corrupt and was being temporarily put to a stop so that there wouldn't be vain bloodshed that wasn't pleasing him, that wasn't following the law. So there's evidence that they were trying to do sacrifices. They were trying to do it at first, but then they stopped doing it. And Josephus tells us, for instance, he says that the Essenes were not allowed to do their sacrifices in the temple. And then he just tells us why. He says they were banned from the temple because they did sacrifices of their own. So it wasn't like they didn't want to be at the temple and participate in it. They were trying to, but they were told, you cannot be here. We're banning you from the temple. They were banned, and I believe that happened in the first century. So they were banned, and they were doing their own sacrifices, and they stopped doing the animal sacrifices because they weren't able to do it in the temple area at the altar. You're supposed to do it at the altar, you know. So, and just one other thing I want to say is that there's this gospel that's being preached and showed to people. They're called the Essene Gospel of Peace, and then there's another one that's Gospel of the Holy Twelve, and people are saying that that's the Essenes Gospel. This is not true. Those documents, they don't have a lot of evidence that those are ancient, authentic documents, and even if they were ancient and authentic, the original publishing of those two books were not published as Essene documents. They were published as just regular documents of, you know, lost scripture. That's what they were being published as. But they weren't connected to the Essenes. The one who published them only connected them to the Essenes after the Dead Sea Scrolls was discovered. So the Essene Gospel of Peace originally was not called that. It was just called, It was Gospel of Peace, or there was Gospel of John or something. But so these documents are not agreeing with the Dead Sea Scrolls, and they don't have a lot of ancient things in them. When you're doing a critical evaluation of these two writings, the Gospel of Peace and the Gospel of the Holy Twelve, you see that it has teachings which are very modern in it. So that's suspect. That makes it suspect. And then secondly, it has in it certain teachings which are just a little bit, it's too close to the guy who published it. So it would be like, I'm trying to think here. I'm having a hard time thinking of a good example, but I'll just say this. It'd be like, For those who know me and how I have some unique beliefs, I have some very interesting ideas, it'd be like me coming out with a writing and saying, look, a writing that I found, and it just happens to have certain beliefs that are like exactly what I believe, you know, in a way that like is kind of unbelievable of how exactly it agrees with what I believe. You know, I believe it because I think it's the truth, but that doesn't mean I expect to find a writing in it that tells it verbatim in an exact correspondence to what I believe. So that makes it unbelievable in many ways, so that these documents that were found, they're too close to what the guy who published them believes. So that throws them into suspicion. And just all the evidence together indicate that those are not Essene writings, and so that even if they are authentic, they're not Essene. So they are not to be considered when we're dealing with the true original Essene group that the Dead Sea Scrolls preserves for us. Now, yeah, for the question was asked by Jason of what about how James the Just's vegetarianism that he had that do I believe that was personal to him? And I believe that was. I believe that that was a special thing that he was doing. And he was, as I said, I believe the avoiding meat is give yourself greater honor. And also, it's much easier and much less time consuming and less work. So for someone like James, who has a lot of responsibility he has to do, and it's a way of making it easier for him to do his mission. But then secondly, it also gives an example to other people that we are to know that even though we have the right or the authority to take life from other people or, you know, from other creatures, that we aren't to just we aren't to take that lightly, and we are to it shows us another way of being more compassionate, being more I have the right to kill you for food, but I'm not going to kill you, creature, because I don't want to do that. I'm giving you some mercy. So it's a way of giving special mercy that we didn't have to give, but it's a lesson. So I think in many ways James was also teaching that, the importance of showing mercy on when you don't have to. And yeah, I don't believe it was official Essene doctrine in his day. I don't see any evidence of that in the scrolls or in the writings of the early witnesses of like Josephus and Philo, telling us what the Essenes believed and did. But as I said, there were other Essene groups, which some of the church fathers speak of, which do not match the scrolls, but which have certain of these characteristics, which are close to Gnosticism, and part of that was rejecting the animals, eating them, and also the sacrifices with that. So hopefully that answers that question. So are there other questions people have? And if you do, share them in the box. We have, so far, the meeting that we've been doing so far is, we are into it 1 hour and 17 minutes. As I said, I'm going to try to keep it under 2 hours. That's the goal of what I want to do every week. Underneath 2 hours, but if people don't want to stay close to 2 hours, we can end it sooner. And if those who are really interested in this and want to know more, we can always extend it a little bit over. It doesn't have to be the same exact thing every single time. It can be a much shorter one some weeks, and other times it can be a longer one than usual. But so if you can, anyone here, share if you have questions, or if you don't, tell me you don't have questions, and then and if no one has questions, then I can share some of my own things that come up to my mind. But so let's see. Yeah, basically I have a major departure from Eisenman. See, Eisenman, he has some interesting ideas, but one of the biggest things that makes him unreliable in terms of finding the truth is he doesn't really accept the scriptures as divinely inspired, authoritative, or not so much trustworthy. You know, he approaches it more from a secular perspective of the scriptures are fake, or they're not really, the prophets didn't really write these things, they were kind of written after the fact, things like that. So when you look at a lot of Eisenman's conclusions, it's based on, he's not an atheist, but it's almost like based on an atheistic outlook, like ignoring the divine, the possibility of divine in understanding these things, and assuming that it could not be originating from divine. Okay, Peter has to go. So Peter, the rest of this is going to be recorded if you want to listen to the rest, and I'll send you the information that you asked about. Thank you for participating. Shalom. So Eisenman, I would avoid mostly what he's saying, especially if you're a new believer. If you are more wise and you understand the scriptures very well, and you're not going to easily be thrown into heresy or false beliefs, then you can read his writings, and you can read and see what he has to say, but you won't be tricked by him. You won't be deceived into believing something that's not true. But so I disagree with Eisenman that James was the teacher of righteousness. To me, when I read these scrolls, when it talks about the teacher of righteousness, it's just, to me, it's so clear talking about Yeshua, or however you pronounce his name, talking about the Messiah. I see certain things in these documents that seem much closer to what happened to the Messiah than what happened to James. And I don't really see any evidence that there was a movement of James where James was held as like a Messiah figure, or as like, you know, the chief person that's the focus of their faith. Because when you look at the scrolls, the teacher of righteousness is like someone they're obsessed about, and someone who's like their entire soul and being. They're like, it just doesn't seem to match so well with James. So I would match it not to James, but I would match it to the Messiah. And then secondly, I believe the Essenes, when they were writing about the teacher of righteousness, did not know who he was, and were writing it years, many years before the Messiah was even born. So I think that their documents talking about the teacher of righteousness are actually a prophecy of a future leader who was to come. They didn't know his name, so that's why they didn't use the names. Because you see in these documents, they don't really use people's names much. And I believe that the reason for that is not to be secretive and so that people don't know, but is that they themselves didn't know the name. And they were, so they would refer to them as these designations. That's my perspective on the teacher of righteousness. Yeah, I think if we were to go through the evidence together, we could show much more compelling evidence that connects the teacher of righteousness to Yeshua rather than to James. And another thing about the teacher of righteousness is that the scholars, you know, they're trying to figure out who the teacher of righteousness is, but the problem is no one that exists fits the bill. No leader of Jewish history that we are aware of fits what is attributed to the teacher of righteousness. So these people have to make up an imaginary figure or imaginary scenario. Like they say, oh, it must have been this Jewish figure, even though we don't have any evidence to support that. And then they make up evidence as a theory of, he must have done this, even though it's not recorded. This must have happened, because he must have been the teacher of righteousness. So they put all of it together in a way that's very unconvincing. And the reason for that is, they're trying to find evidence for someone who doesn't exist, because no teacher of righteousness existed in the time period that they're looking at. At least that's the best, from what I can tell, there's no evidence that ever indicates that there was a teacher of righteousness. So they're looking at for him in the wrong century, the wrong time period. And the reason they're doing that is because they don't believe in prophecy. So because it's very certain that most of these writings were written before the Messiah was born, in their mind, oh, then it couldn't have been the Messiah, because it couldn't have been Yeshua, because he was born later. But that's a false conclusion based on the assumption that prophecy is not possible. But as believers, we know it is possible. So that they're clearly placing the teacher of righteousness in the wrong century. I can show in the future, hopefully, certain things about the teacher of righteousness which match so well with Yeshua that it has to be Yeshua in my mind. So let me see here. Okay, there was another question asked before, but I'm gonna answer the one about the teacher of righteousness, since we're on the same topic. The question was asked by Melissa, that she says, I heard today in the community rule that when the Messiah would come, he would tell them what to do. Almost like their theology was temporary, or no. And is teacher of righteousness in Greek or Hebrew? That phrase, teacher of righteousness, is a Hebrew phrase. It was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's also used in the Bible in one place, in like Hosea. And basically, it's not that their theology was temporary, it's that, just like in the Law of Moses, it says in Deuteronomy chapter 18, it says, a prophet like Moses will come, and whoever does not hear or listen to that prophet and obey what that prophet is saying, he will be held accountable. That says that in Deuteronomy 18. And so the Essenes interpreted this Messiah, or this prophet like Moses figure, as the Messiah that was to come. So when they said that when the Messiah would come, he would tell them what to do, it's not saying that their theology was temporary, or that, you know, their beliefs were not set in stone, but rather it was, we are following the truth, but when the Messiah comes, he's going to give us more truth that we also have to follow. So it wasn't an issue of, we don't know what the truth is, so we're just going to follow as best we understand, and then when he comes, then he'll fix our errors. It wasn't like that. Rather, it was, we know the truth, we're going to follow it, but there will be more truth, because there will be more prophets, and the Messiah will come, he's going to teach us more things that are truth, and then we got to follow that, whatever that is. And the scriptures teach that he's going to bring in a new covenant and new laws that we have to follow. And so that's their position. That's how they took it. Now, the question was asked by Sean, do you think that some people today could be considered priests? So there's the Levitical priesthood, and then there's the Melchizedek priesthood. In my understanding, the scriptures teach for the Levitical system that those sacrifices must be done by the priesthood of Aaron. Okay? And so those sacrifices must always be in that place, in that proper specifications. And I believe that that's still to be done, but it'll be restored in a future time when the temple is built again, and when the priests are doing their sacrifices, that's when it'll be restored again. But outside of the Levitical system, I believe that there are authentic priests that can be done. And this is based on certain documents in other writings by the apostles. In the New Testament, as I've mentioned before, of the Ethiopian church, their Bible is the biggest. It has in the Old Testament, it has Jubilees, Enoch, an extra Jeremiah, Apocrypha, and it has Second Esdras. It has so many extra books. And because it has Enoch and Jubilees, which agrees with the Essenes and the Dead Sea Scrolls, they're the only church that agrees with so closely with the Essene foundation that we have to take into consideration maybe their New Testament also is the closest group to the truth as well. And when we look at their New Testament, they have 8 extra books, and those extra books in their New Testament have so many things that are like that the Essenes believed and are similar to them, that I have to conclude that the New Testament writers and the apostles were Essenes, because there's just so many connections. So in these 8 extra books of the Ethiopian New Testament, it gives laws for the New Covenant. And in the main things in the New Covenant, which were not in the Old, is about the Melchizedek priesthood. It tells us why the Melchizedek priesthood was needed. Basically, it tells us certain things about the Old Covenant that the Old Covenant could not accomplish, it could not do through the Levitical priesthood. So it explains what the purpose is of the New Covenant. It gives laws for how that priesthood is to work, how to do the priests, how to do sacrifices, how to do the sanctuaries, and it follows so many things, so many principles of the law. There's so many similarities of identical things. And there's new holy days that they introduce in the New Covenant. New holy days. So basically new worship commandments are the main extra things of the New Covenant that are in these writings. So I do believe the priests, I do believe there are new priests that can be done, but it has to be done according to the New Covenant laws, and most people don't have these books, so they don't know what the requirements are. So I don't believe that you can just say, I'm going to be a priest, and you're going to start doing sacrifices. Well, first of all, you don't know what kind of sacrifices you're allowed to do or that you're supposed to do. And secondly, you don't know how to become a priest. How do you do that? There's a process, according to the apostles. You don't just declare yourself a priest. So there's things like that where the idea of the priest is valid in the Melchizedek system, but you're not supposed to just do it unless you know how to do it. So that's how I would say for that. And another thing is that the new covenant they give, the laws that they give, there's extra laws that are like, they repeat some of the old laws and give greater detail on how to apply it or how to understand it. They give commentary on the gospel account and give extra information of what he taught the apostles. And that these writings claim to be written by the apostles themselves, all together in a council, and they all declare, they all come up together and gather what they were told by the Messiah and compile it into a book of law for the people. And there's just so many agreements with the Nazarenes, the Nazarene Jews, and the Essenes, which lead me to conclude that these books are legitimate and authentic, and that they solidify the connection of the apostles with the Essenes. And so, now a question was asked, what new holy days? That's a controversial question of the what new holy days, because basically, here's the system. According to these documents, you've got, it basically tells you, it says, obey the law of Moses, and obey the new law. So it's telling you to do both. But here's where the church went wrong. The church basically said, the old, don't do that anymore. Follow the new. But then what did they do for the new? Not only did they say, don't follow the old, they also altered the new and took in some pagan elements, you know, and they mixed it together. So, for the issue of, for instance, for the new holy days, what are the new holy days that these books teach? They are days which are connected with the Messiah's atoning work, his redemptive thing. When you look in the Old Testament, like for Jubilees, for instance, every holy day was to redeem people, to save people, to purify, and to as a covenant between people. And that's what we're seeing with these new days in the New Covenant, is that they were special days all about the atonement and redemption of the people through the Messiah. And, look, so just to give an example. So, you know how the church says Christmas, right? So, let's think for a minute. If a Christian were to write a document saying, I'm going to write a book that says we have to keep Christmas, what would they say? They would write the date of Christmas, right? They would say December 25th, the 25th of the 10th month. Or they would say with the Orthodox Church, the 6th of January. But that's not what we see in this. Instead, what we see in this is not the 25th of the 10th month, but it tells us the 25th of the 9th month. Now that's very important, because if you know that date, that date in the Hebrew calendar, the 25th of the 9th month, is the first day of Hanukkah. So can you think for a second, if a Christian was like making a forgery, why would they make a writing that says, keep honor his day of birth on Hanukkah? You know, that doesn't make sense. A Christian would not write that. A Jew would write that of, keep, you know, Hanukkah. And so, for instance, that's one particular one, you know, a Hanukkah thing, of celebrating when he came. And then another one is, you see, each of these new holy days correspond with holy days in the Old Testament. So there's like, you know how there's a Day of Atonement in the Old Testament? There's also a special Day of Atonement in these new law, which is right around the time of Passover. It's right around the time of Passover, and it's like the same thing as Day of Atonement, but it's a new one that is focusing on when he died. Because here's the thing. In Jubilees, what are we told in Jubilees? We're told that Jacob believed that Joseph had died. And because Joseph died, he fasted, and that's why Day of Atonement has to be kept, because of Jacob's sadness for Joseph. So imagine, if we have to do Day of Atonement because of Joseph, it would make much more sense if we had to do a special Day of Atonement when the Messiah was dead. You know, that he's the ultimate one. So that's the mindset here of, it's a similar thing. That's what the Ethiopian books are saying. And there's also similar thing with like Passover. There's a parallel thing, an extra thing, and they called it Passover. They didn't call it Easter. Easter is a term that originated by the English. It was never originally called that. You know, so there's different things like that where these new holy days, they're similar to what the church is saying, but they're different. There's important differences which don't have the pagan stuff mixed in, because we know that the church mixed up the pagan stuff, like with Christmas. First of all, it's on the wrong day. They have it on the wrong day. And then secondly, they have Christmas trees and all sorts of pagan stuff mixed in. So it seems to me that the church was following tradition, and that some of the tradition was based on truth, but it's not good enough to be based on truth. You know, so they changed it, they altered it, and their holy days that they're doing now are not holy anymore. They're on the wrong days, and they're incorporating pagan stuff into it. So that's just to give you a idea. Those aren't all the new holy days that I mentioned, but basically just so you know, if you look at the church and look at their holy days, then you see, okay, what's their holy days? And then basically the new holy days is a Jewish or a more purer version of what the church is saying. It's a purer version of what the church is saying. And you can look at the Ethiopian church to see what they're doing, but even the Ethiopian church is not doing it right exactly. So hopefully that answers your question, Melissa, about these new holy days that I mentioned in these 8 extra books of the Ethiopian New Testament. And then this other question, let's see. So Jason says, so something like the Mishatha Kidon is a genuine tradition of Yeshua, in your opinion. Are you able to briefly explain what that is? Because I'm not familiar with that phrase. I might be familiar with the concept, but I don't remember seeing that phrase. If there's a quick way you can tell me what that is, then please do, so I can answer that. But otherwise, I don't want to look it up and take the time to look it up, because it might take too long to figure it out. But otherwise, yeah, I'm not sure. Oh, it's a... Okay, yeah, so the Ethiopian New Testament. Let me go to that. Ethiopian Orthodox Bible Canon. Let's see here. So I'm gonna go here and show you what it says about these books, based on your question. So the extra books are part of the New Testament. There is there is Synodos, there is the Book of the Covenant, which is called here, what he just said was Mashatha Kidon, and then there's also the Ethiopian Clement, or Kalamentos, and there's the Didascalia, and the Synodos are divided into 4 different books. So these are the books all together. All 8 of these books are in the Ethiopian Bible and in no other Bible, and they are full of the extra information of the New Covenant. So just to explain, I have access to all these books, and just to explain what is in them. Okay, I was looking for these books for years because I wanted to read them, and I believed that they were scripture, so I was trying to find them. It took me a while to find them. I was able to contact the guy who translated them and some of them, and through a long time of searching, I found these documents. And so, basically, the Synodos, they are similar to Leviticus, okay? It basically goes through in a similar fashion. It gives the laws for the priests of how to do certain things. It's specifically for the priests. It's not for, you know, the regular people. Like, just like Leviticus, Leviticus gives laws for the priesthood, for the Levites. Here's how you do this, Levites. It's a similar concept. The Book of the Covenant, it's kind of, I would say, it corresponds a lot with the similarities with the Book of Exodus in arrangement, where it gives the terms of the new of the covenant, and then it gives laws for the tabernacle. So just like in Exodus, it gives laws for how to build the tabernacle, how to construct the holy place, the sanctuary. It does the same thing for the this Book of the Covenant in the Ethiopian Bible. The Ethiopian word that they call it is Mishafa Kidan, and that's the book that they go into similar things that Exodus goes into, but in the New Testament context of a new priesthood and a new system. And it also gives some prophecy from the Messiah. And then there's a letter that the apostles wrote. A letter that the apostles wrote detailing teachings of the Messiah that he gave to them. And they explain that. It's the letter of the apostles. And that's preserved in full in Ethiopian. And that's part of that Book of Covenant book. Didascalia corresponds very well with Deuteronomy. And Numbers as well. It's like Didascalia in the Ethiopian Bible is actually two different books. It is Didascalia, the original version, and then it's the original version of Didache, if you've heard of Didache. The Didascalia is the combined version of both of those. The original Didache follows more along the idea of Numbers. Follows along more of that system, and the Didascalia portion follows really closely with like a Deuteronomy type of thing, and it focuses on Deuteronomy of the Old Testament, and it basically is goes over the entire law, the principles of the law. And just like Deuteronomy, how in Deuteronomy Moses is giving speeches and covering over the history of the Israelites, it does the same thing for the Didascalia, where it covers the history of the apostles and some of what the Messiah did, and just kind of gives an update of what happened throughout their journeys and until the point where they are at that time, gathered together, making that declaration. So it's what's amazing is that these extra writings follow along very similar to like a Law of Moses type of thing, but instead it's a Law of Messiah and gives extra things, which are really very amazing stuff, I find. And the other book is the Ethiopic Clement, and that one is like a revelation of Peter, and it goes into so much detail, and there's like so many amazing things in that book. If you were to read it, you'd be like, wow, you know, this is amazing, because that's one of the only books, the Ethiopian Clement, which gives it tells us explicitly, it says, anyone who eats unclean food as the law prohibits, they have sinned, they must repent, and they have to fast for repentance. They're banned from the church until they finish their repentance. Would a Christian write that? You know, not really. You know, that seems very strong connection to the true apostle teaching. And then you have, you also have the apostles you have in this book of Clement. It says, no one is allowed to enter the church or, you know, a sanctuary, holy place, if they are unclean. And then it gives the different things you can be unclean by. You know, leprosy. A leper is not to enter the church. A woman who's menstruating is not allowed to enter the church. A woman who has given birth to a child of 40 days or 80 days is not to enter. You know, and it's someone who has had an emission of semen is not allowed to enter into the church. This is exactly what the law is saying, but for a holy place. So we're seeing, like, it's a very Old Testament type of thinking in this book, but it's like in a New Testament priesthood context. And so, yeah, that book of Clement is one of my favorite books because there's so much amazing stuff in it. It hasn't been translated into English fully yet. But I've done a little bit of translation myself. I've done a Google translation of it, for instance, and it reads amazingly in it, what I see. So, let's see, that's the basic understanding of the what the contents are of the New Testament of the Ethiopian Bible. I'll say one thing about that is that the Ethiopian version of those books, when you compare them, for instance, to the Greek and the Latin, like for Didascalia, the Greek and the Latin, much more the Latin reads like really anti-Torah. It reads like anti-law of Moses, extreme. The Greek, not as much, but it still has some things in it which are really off, at least how it's translated anyway. It seems off anyway. The Ethiopian text, when you compare it, you have to come to two. You can only come to two different conclusions. Is that the Ethiopian is the original version, and it was because the Ethiopian text, like, is much pro Torah, like much more pro Torah in how it reads. It's like amazingly, like it's strikingly when you compare it to the Greek text and the Latin. It's just certain passages would seem anti Torah are not in the Ethiopian, or if they are, they're worded in a way that's like much better. So either that's the original version and the Greek and the Latin versions were like fabricated by scribes to be more anti-Torah, or this is kind of what I'm leaning on. The other option is that the original version seemed anti-Torah when it wasn't really, and at least for the Greek, the Latin I think probably is anti-Torah, but the Greek version seemed anti-Torah, but wasn't really. It was just rendered improperly in the Greek. And the Ethiopians, who got their version, they didn't like what this was saying because they knew that it was Greek disagreeing with the law. And it didn't seem to make sense. They thought it was a contradiction with the scriptures because the Ethiopian church is actually very Torah observant. They keep the law of Moses. So they were able to, I think that they rendered things more pro-Torah because they knew that the Torah was the truth. So I personally believe that the Ethiopians didn't always have the correct original text, but that they translated it in a way which was safer and closer to the truth than how the Greek version seems to say. So if people read the Greek version, for instance, and find things in it that they just can't accept, try reading the Ethiopian version, because the Ethiopian is much easier to accept and much more faithful to, it seems much more faithful to the truth. So, all right, Sandra, you said you have to leave now. Thank you for coming. So I'll just try to finish this up, because we've been here for a while. So I'll just answer the final questions here. How were these teachings transported to such a far-off locale in such an unpolluted form? So I'll basically present... I think this will be a good place to end it. This is where I'm gonna give the final explanation of the answer to that question, and then we'll end it for this week. So, basically, when you go through history of the church divided every so often. They had a major schism. And the farther back and closer to the apostles you go, the less control the Catholics had. So, originally, you had the true believers mixed in with anti-Torah people. And it was all, you know, it was a very diverse group of believers of the Messiah. Then after Constantine came, you know, Constantine kind of Romanized, he unified the church under a Roman head. And then, about 100 years after that, I think it was 454, there was a major controversy. And this controversy had to do with the Messiah's identity. It was debating whether he was God or not, or how he was God and how he was man. How did that work together? There was a division, a schism. The one side believed that he was God and man. That there was a Jesus God and a Jesus man, and that they were not the same. They were two different ones. And that the Jesus man died on the cross, but that the Jesus God did not, because he's God, he can't die. That's what the Catholics and the Latins and the Greeks believed that. The other side, which was closer to the truth, these were the Orientals, the Easterners, the Eastern believers, which amongst those were the faithful people. Not all of them, but the faithful were in the Eastern group, and the Eastern group was closer to the truth. They said, "No, that's not the truth. It's not that the man Jesus died and that the God Jesus didn't, because he's God. No, the man Jesus and God Jesus died because they're the same individual, and he's not God in the same sense the Father is. He's a different, you know, he's a lesser." Compared to the Father, you know, he's begotten, Son of God. That's what the Eastern group believed. So they divided on that issue. The Easterners had when they broke away, with most of those extra books. They also broke away with more of the teachings that were closer to the original group. So when you read in the Old Testament, when you read that Judah, there was the two kingdoms, right? There was the Israel, and then they split into the northern and southern kingdom, the 10 tribes and the 2 tribes. What we read in the scriptures in the Old Testament is that after like one or two generations, the 10 tribes did not like what was going on in the kingdom of Israel. There was a lot of evil. So what did they do? All the true believers, all the people who wanted to follow the law, they left. They left the kingdom of Israel and went to the kingdom of Judah. It says that in Kings or Chronicles. I can't remember which one. So that would be the equivalent of you having America, and then you having, okay, all the Republicans are going to move out of America. That would essentially make, you know, that would completely change America into a, you know, an average, like, you know, off and on Republican Democrat thing. It would be completely Democrat, and it would go off the deep end into, you know, major pro-abortion and homosexuality and, you know, all that stuff, anti-Bible to the extreme. But with the Republican force there, it's kind of balancing it out a little bit. So that's similar what happened with the Old Testament, where the good people from the 10 tribes, they left and went to Judah. That basically made the kingdom of Israel into a horribly wicked nation because all the good people left, so now there's only horrible people in the kingdom. That's the exact same thing that happened with the church, is that the eastern branch broke away from the western branch and took all the good stuff out of it. What remained was the Catholics and the Greek Orthodox, so the Latins and the Greeks. And they were, most of the extra books they didn't have anymore, they didn't accept, and they didn't follow the Law of Moses. But the Law of Moses teachings and the extra books were confined mostly to the Eastern churches. So that's really how that happened. And then in regards to these books in the Ethiopian Bible, here's how that happened. The main group of the Eastern churches was Egypt. Egypt was the main group. Egypt and Syria. Syria was like a sister, but it was really Egypt that was the focus. Because even in the early church, the ones from Egypt had the extra books, and they had many of the closer, a lot of truth in them. But they also had some falsehood too, so it was a mix. But the Egyptians had a lot of those extra books, and so how it happened was the Egyptian church, had their extra books, had some of their teachings, but they had some Egyptians which followed the law and which accepted all these extra books, and then other Egyptians were like, some of the law is okay, but some of it we don't accept. And some of these extra books maybe, but most of them, no, we don't. So there was like a divide amongst the Egyptians as well. There was different camps like that. The Egyptians were conquered by the Muslims. Okay, they were conquered by the Muslims when the Muslims rose, and they made Egyptians learn Arabic, and that's why Egypt today still speaks in Arabic as their main language, because they were changed by the Muslims through conquering Egypt. But so all the writings in Egyptian, they were actually in Coptic. They were translated into Arabic for the Egyptian churches. Then the Ethiopian church was part of the Egyptian church. The Ethiopians eventually got permission to break away from the Egyptian church. That happened only a few hundred years ago. The Ethiopians said, we would like to have our own church group because we would like to have our own authority on things. And the Egyptians, I don't remember the full reason of why they said okay, but it probably had something to do with, you know, it's kind of difficult to have control over people that are in another nation. So they said, okay, you can break away. That's fine. You can have your own group. As long as you stay in communion with us and remain our brothers, we'll let you break away. So that's what they did. The Ethiopian church broke away from the Egyptian church, and that was the birth of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. That was a few hundred years ago. The Ethiopian church got their documents from the Egyptian church. How they get them from it? Well, they were in Arabic, and they had to be translated from Arabic into Ethiopian. And that's how it happened. Most of the Ethiopian documents were translated from Arabic into the Ethiopian, and that's how they preserved most of the pure teachings, because the Ethiopians came from that group they came from the Egyptian group that was more accepting of the extra books and which was focusing on the Law of Moses. The Ethiopians said, give us these books. We believe they're scripture. Give them to us. And then they read them and saw so much Law of Moses stuff in it. So they said, all right, we got to follow this. And that's why they're so pure and close to the truth, is because they're just following what the Bible says that they were given. They're trying to be, you know, sincerely follow the full Bible as they have it. And they have more of the Bible than we do or any other group. So the more Bible that you have, the more likely you'll come to the truth and follow the truth. So since they have their Bible is 81 books, eight extra books in their New Testament, and then so many extra books in their Old Testament, and translated from the Septuagint instead of the Masoretic, so they just have a better version of the Old Testament, a better version of the New Testament, So that's really how they, you know, they had so much extra information that that's how they were able to be faithful. So that's, hopefully that answers the question. And any other final thoughts? But otherwise, we will end it. But so yeah, if there's any other thoughts, let me know in the box. And we will hopefully you guys will want to join in next week when we do this again. You're welcome, Sean. Thank you for coming. And I saw you had you lost connection several times at the beginning, but I'm glad you were able to see most of you know, save for the second half especially. All right, looks like it's all good. Thank you guys for participating, and I know you guys didn't see the whole thing because some of you guys joined in late and got knocked out a couple times. So if you want to listen to the whole thing, I'm going to be loading this to YouTube, and I'll post a link on Facebook, and you can watch it. So any more questions, ask me on Facebook. I'll be happy to answer them. Shalom.